Welcome back. You're with Ray Bonney. It's Hits and Giggles on 94.1 FM. It's 3WBC, and waiting on the phone with my makeshift technology this morning is the amazing Pete Nichols. Good morning, Pete.
Good morning, Ray. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well, thank you. It seems like you're coming through loud and clear on my, as I said, my makeshift broadcasting equipment here this morning. Now, you said you're not a fan of doing live interviews, so I'm going to make this as painless as possible for you.
Thank you very much for that.
Now, Pete Nichols, he is the CEO of Parents Beyond Breakup, which is a national charity working in many communities across Australia and focusing on suicide prevention in one of the most risky demographics, and that's separating parents. So, Pete, how did you become involved in Parents Beyond Breakup? Because you also encapsulate dads in distress as well, don't you?
That's right. Right. So, I mean, there's a bit of a history by background, which is, although my dodgy accent would suggest that I stem from the UK, which I do.
Really?
Australia. Well, Australia is my home now, and it's the place I love. But a long time ago, back in the UK, I went through a really difficult separation myself and was separated from my daughter for about 11 years. Yeah. And we resolved that particular kind of challenge, and my ex-partner and myself are now best friends. However, it did lead me to understand some of the challenges that parents go through, both mums and dads. I mean, it's predominantly dads by numbers, but both mums and dads go through in terms of separation from their kids. So when I arrived here in Australia, I started volunteering as a facilitator for a dads in distress group, looking after the kind of mental health needs of dads who are going through separation or very traumatic and high conflict situations. And at some point I got involved on the board as well to try and help steer the direction of the organization. And then, For reasons unknown to me, the board decided they thought they should put me in charge and make me the CEO. So that's where I am today.
Because you are a bit rock and roll, aren't you? You know,
I do enjoy a bit of a drama and getting up and getting something done. So yeah.
No, it's you and I spent a bit of time on the Gold Coast this past weekend. Are you still there, actually? You are.
Well, no, actually, I went back to Sydney and I'm now in Brisbane, so I tend to fly around quite a bit, I'm afraid.
Oh, he's also a jet setter, folks. And but we were together at the 2017 International Conference on Men's Issues, and you and I actually sat on a panel together and, you know, discussed some of these issues. And, you know, we like to clarify when we're talking about men's issues, it's not to the exclusion of women at all. It's just about bringing some issues that really do affect men. And, you know, Pete, in my work, there's not a day that goes by that I don't talk to a man who's experiencing grief and loss around, you know, breakup of relationship.
Yeah. Well, it's actually quite a set of circumstances, because, you know, if we were to look at any individual out there that would ring up a helpline, for example, and say, I've just lost access to my home, or I've lost my partner, I've lost my child, I've got myself into debt, you know, any of those kind of issues individually, we would say they're at risk of suicide, and we would lend a helping hand. I mean, and quite often, though, when you're looking at people who are going through separation, all of those things can happen almost instantaneously at the same time.
Yes.
It's quite an extreme set of stresses on the individual, particularly when it comes out of the blue.
So on that, you know, and you think about the work that Parents Beyond Breakup do and Dads in Distress, what sort of support do you think, you know, our community as a whole provides for men in particular who experience that, you know, all-encompassing, you know, set of circumstances?
Well, if we look at it in a broad context, then as a society, generally across the Western world, we're not very good at caring for men's needs. And so if we look particularly here in Australia, then the reality is there's disparate services which are really good to support men going through these kind of situations. But on a national basis, it really does come down to dads in distress, mums in distress as discrete services, and they are kind of services of an overall organization called Parents Beyond Breakup for whom I work. But really it does come down to the kind of peer support groups that we set up in kind of 18 locations around Australia where we get these people together in a room. Mm. It's quite attractive to the men, actually. I mean, men are quite often accused of not talking. But actually, if you create the right environment, they're very happy to talk, as long as they're listened to with empathy.
Yes.
You know, and so that's what we do. We create those kind of environments which men not only find them attractive, but they also like coming to them, and they get something really good out of the peer support group that they sit in each week.
Yes, and I think it's absolutely critical that we start bringing these services a bit out into the light as well. Now, as you said, you know, a lot of services for men aren't very accessible and very well known because of the associated stigma with men's issues that we experience all the time. And, you know, we don't talk. And, you know, if we're not talking about it, how are we creating environments where men can actually talk about how they're feeling without being invalidated?
Sure. Well, in fact, I mean, just to share one little insight, one of the reasons I'm in Brisbane at the moment is because I spoke at a Stop Male Suicide conference yesterday.
Wow.
There was a phenomenal lady that spoke. Her name was Jane. I can't remember her surname, but she spoke about how men are the way women would expect them to be. You know, if you look at how we've evolved as human beings, the people that we mate with are the ones that we find attractive. So what you end up with today is largely a product of, you know, millions of years of people deciding who they think is the right partner. So the way women are is the way men find them attractive, and the way men are is the way women find them attractive. And I think what she was suggesting was that she was asking the audience, for example, if a man does show vulnerability rather than absolute stoic strength all the time, is that a good thing or a bad thing? And it's quite, you know, if you looked at the audience's responses, quite honestly, people would say that's not what we want to see in men.
Yes.
So it is difficult. So men are kind of faced with this issue where they have to be strong. They mustn't show emotion. They shouldn't talk. They shouldn't show any weakness. But it does, unfortunately, lead to the point where, you know, you can reach that tipping point and say, well, I can't deal with this anymore. And suicide becomes a logical option when, you know, everything else seems hopeless.
Oh, and far too often, Pete, we know of the 8 suicides every single day in Australia that we know of. 6 of those are men, and that's a daily occurrence. And I don't think that we can turn away from, you know, that's just not a statistic, that's a reality. So thank you for the work that you're doing. It's amazing, and I'm so glad that I accidentally met you in the boardroom that day at Who Group.
Well, likewise, Ray.
That 2-hour meeting. Now, next up, we actually have your mate and my new mate, Amanda Sillars, and she's a lived experience educator and public speaker on parental alienation, founder of the Eeny, Meeny, Miney, Moe Foundation. In fact, you two were together last night travelling somewhere.
Well, we went to the Dads in Distress meeting in Brisbane.
Yes.
So both Amanda and I spoke at the Stop Male Suicide Conference.
Yes.
And then I took the opportunity of being in Brisbane to actually go to our local group. She came with me.
Yes.
And that was really interesting. And in fact, the men were really happy to see her, and she took them through a little bit about, you know, what it is to be alienated as a parent.
Yes. And of course, I would love to see her because she is incredibly aesthetically pleasing to the eye as well.
I couldn't possibly comment on that one.
All right, Pete. Well, thank you for coming on the show here at 3WBC today and sharing some of your insights. And I led you into all of those questions because that's what I get up for every day is helping provide environments that, you know, stop men from wanting to kill themselves.
Sure. Okay.
Now, do you want to intro this song for me?
Yes, absolutely. Well, just before I do so, I should say that I have 2 daughters, one who lives with me now and one, unfortunately, because of family law, I can't see.
Yes.
So this song is a little bit for her. So if I do my intro, it's you're listening to 94.1 FM, 3WBC, with the amazing, incredible Ray Bonney with her hits and giggles. Next up,
I wrote that.
Vanilla Twilight, a song by Owl City. This is a song for my second daughter from whom I'm parted. The words are those that I whisper to her in my quietest moments.
Well, that's really special. Thank you for sharing this with me and our listeners, Pete. You have a great day.
And you. Thank you very much.
See ya.
Bye-bye. The stars lean down to kiss you, and I lie awake and miss you. Pour me a heavy dose of atmosphere. 'Cause I'll doze off safe and soundly, but I'll miss your arms around me. I'd send a postcard to you, dear, 'cause I wish you were here.
same without you, because it takes two to whisper quietly. The silence isn't so bad till I look at my hands and feel sad, 'cause the spaces between my fingers are right where yours fit perfectly. I'll find repose in new ways, though I haven't slept in 2 days, 'cause cold nostalgia chills me to the bone. But drenched in vanilla twilight, I'll sit on the front porch all night, waist deep in thought, because when I think of you, I don't feel so alone. I don't feel so.
Well, there you have it. That was a beautiful song for my last guest, Pete Nichols. It's a song by Owl City called Vanilla Twilight, and that was for his daughter. So you're listening to 94.1 FM. It's 3WBC. The time now is 30 minutes past 9 o'clock, and it's the 16th of June 2017, heading very closely to the shortest day of the year, which is the 21st of June sometime next week. But on the phone right now, I have another special guest relating to the recent conference that I attended, the 2017 International Men's Issues Conference. We have Amanda Siles on the phone. Good morning, Amanda.
Good morning, Ray. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Very well. And I am sitting here in the studios at 3WBC. I've got one hand in the air with my mobile up against the guest mic. So you are literally speaking directly into the guest mic and juggling everything else as well. Now, Amanda, I met you recently at the conference, as I just said, and you're a lived experience educator and public speaker on parental alienation, and you're a gender inclusive advocate and founder of the Eeny, Meeny, Miney, Mo Foundation. I was fascinated with your story, and I just wondered if you'd be able to share a bit of that with myself and the guests today.
Yeah, sure can. Basically, from a young age, I was taken from my mum at age 11 and taken to America 14,000 kilometres away by my dad. And during that time, I was manipulated to believe that my dad was, you know, my saviour, and that my mum was a bad person and not worthy of having me in her life, or my brother. And during that time, you lose your identity, you know, when you're being led to believe that one of your parents is a bad person, and you're being told all sorts of lies and histories being repainted. as if it was bad. When I was 18, I decided to come back to Australia on my own to Perth and try and find my mum. And when I did find my mum, she was quite a broken woman from everything that she'd been experiencing. And I had also had a lot of my own problems as well. Mm. You know, I had obsessive exercise routines and eating disorder and all sorts of things and, you know, suppressed memories and also false memories.
Yes.
And when I tried to reunite with her, I was obviously this brainwashed child that, you know, thought that she didn't care and all this sort of stuff. So our meeting didn't really go that well. And she thought that I was very much like my dad.
Mm.
And I didn't understand her situation and she didn't understand my situation. So it was a really bad, you know, it was a bad, you know, position that we were both in at that time.
Mm.
And unfortunately, my mum ended up taking her life as a result of everything that went on for those 7 or 8 years.
Mm.
And then as most children do, they usually choose a partner in life very much like, you know, their parent, their role model.
Mm.
And I chose a man very much like my own father. And even he was a salesman as well, a technical salesperson, had big white, you know, teeth, very charming, very good at telling people what they want to hear. And I found it very difficult, the relationship I was in, and I ended up separating. And years after separation, I mean, there was things that were happening during the relationship that I didn't really see what was going on. I didn't realise that I was being misrepresented to many people, far and wide. And my children were slowly being turned against me. Everything good I was doing was being turned into something bad. And everything was just being distorted. And eventually my children, when they went, he actually moved away. It was an isolation tactic.
Mm.
Kids went on holiday and he didn't put them on the plane. And I couldn't get a recovery order on them because they had been manipulated to say that I was an abusive mum when I had never been abusive to my children.
Mm. Mm. What a terrible...
There's one good part of the story.
Yes.
Is that I've actually now got my son back now with me.
Yes.
He came back in September 2015 on his own accord and now lives with me full time.
So it's no wonder you're so inspired with the work that you do at Eeny, Meeny, Miny, Mo Foundation and, you know, absolutely in awe of, you know, you being able to actually get up in the morning and go out and help other people in, you know, I don't think it sounds like there's... anyone has a similar situation, but the heartbreak of losing a child that's still living must be just overwhelming.
Oh, it is, and it's like I can actually relate to what my mum experienced because I've experienced it myself, you know, the despair and the grief and the, you know, it's like you're mourning for a child that's still living.
Yes.
You know, and I had two children which I had no contact with. Every time I flew across to see them, they would run like scared cats.
Yes.
You know, and it's like, what have I done? You know, and you start you almost start believing that you're not a good person because
yes.
you've got all this bad stuff being said about you. And, you know, and this is what I always tell parents, is that you've got to look back at all those good memories and believe in yourself and just don't give up and really understand the position that your child is. And even though you're grieving yourself, you've actually really got to educate and learn about how sinister this form of abuse is and
yes.
what it can actually do to your children and long-term impact it has.
And look, before meeting you, it's not something that I've given a great deal of thought to, I guess. You know, there's so many things on my radar in relation to mental health challenges or just the health challenges of the human condition. And, you know, you really opened my eyes to just the amount of people that experience parental alienation. And I thank you so much for the work that you're doing. That's really helping support people. I know that you mentioned more than 800 people. Mums and dads come together in your support group to support each other.
Yeah, we've got, I think it's 970 parents in our support group at the moment.
Wow.
And we started a New Zealand support group where we've just, I think it was about 92 people. And this group has only just been going for about a month, but we just had this huge demand in New Zealand as well.
Yes.
Of parents that just have got there's no solutions, there's no therapies there for them, or the children. And people that are working in this industry have got no idea. I mean, we do have a couple of experts in Australia, but then we've got so many people
yes.
who've got no idea how to diagnose these cases, and in fact, they make them worse.
Well, it's hard to see, isn't it? Because, you know, stigma. I mean, stigma is such a terrible thing in any setting, but when you look at your setting in particular, the stigma around alienated parents is that you're a bad parent. If you don't have your children, you're a bad parent, and that's the stereotype, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, often when people see a parent without their child, that, you know, over time, like, you know, they said, sort of thought, well, you know, you often hear men don't have, you know, custody of their kids, and it's unfortunate it's been made normal, which is just so wrong. It should be, you know, the child should be with both parents. But then when you see a mum without her kids, we've got more women coming out now because people think, well, if you're a mum without your kids, you definitely must have done something wrong. You must have been abusive, aggressive or something for your kids to reject you. And those people are obviously people that don't understand emotional abuse and how it can actually completely destroy a relationship between a parent and a child.
Yes, definitely. Well, Amanda, thank you for sharing all of that with me today. I am going to plan to have you on my Monday show over the next few months. My Monday show, it's called It's Okay to Not Be Okay. So I think it's a perfect setting to talk in more detail about the work that you do and, you know, some of the ways that communities can help support through reducing that stigma and stereotyping around this really, really important issue. So you do have a song, though. Do you want to tell me about the song that you've requested?
Yeah, so there's a song I learnt to play on the piano when my mum was going through a really tough time while my parents were, you know, separating. And it was also when my mum took her life just before I had met with her and she gave me a rose. So it's Bette Midler, The Rose.
There you go. Well, you're listening to 94.1 FM. It's 3WBC and you're here with Ray Bonnie with Hits and Giggles, and we've just been speaking with Amanda Sillis, and she does amazing work around parental alienation and also has her own devastating experience in relation to the same thing. So thank you, Amanda. You have a beautiful day, and please enjoy this song.
Thank you very much, Ray. Same to you. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Some say love, it is a river that drowns the tender reed. Some say love, it is a razor that leaves your soul to bleed. Some say love, it is a hunger, an endless aching need. I say love, it is a flower, and you, it's only seed. Winter.
And there you have it. Doesn't get much more beautiful than Bette Midler and her rose. That was a song for my last guest, Amanda Sillis. She was talking to me about, or talking to us about, parental alienation and all the amazing work she does with so many families who are experiencing the grief and horror and loss through parental alienation.